Photographical clues and curiosities.
We will start with fossilized animal tracks. Take a good look at the rock layer these tracks are planted in. Notice the preserved detail. Can we find a match to common natural ones? Forest floors are full of debris consisting of bugs, plants, sticks, and roots. In these photos, do you see large quantities of debris, or even imprints of debris? If footsteps left imprints, wouldn't you expect sticks and roots would have also? The forest floor does not look like a match. Quality footprints clearly would not form in grasslands. Could the footprints have formed in the desert? Dry sand tracks have no definition. Also notice the large, not very flat sand dunes. Does dry sand appear to be a visual match to you? And on the beach, footprints would get washed away or blown away. Prints under the ocean would simply not work or last. Stepping on rock does not leave tracks. In a brief moment, we have ruled out the majority of the earth. If we look at mud, we can see definition left behind in the footprints. Is mud a visual match to you? But what should happen next? The mud dries and cracks. But in this story, there was an even, wide, flat, muddy surface. Animals came by and left their tracks. And then another even, wide, flat layer appeared on top, not disturbing the first. Oddly enough, they did not bond to each other. Next, notice there is no foliage in any of these photos. Obviously, this layer was horizontal at one point, and now it has tipped on its side. This is just a fragment of a much larger layer. This tells me animals were running around on top of the barren layers, and there is no vegetation to be found. Could have these animals been fighting for survival as these layers of earth were being created? The next time you're looking at rock layers, notice you are unlikely to spot roots. We can all agree, most animals do not live underground. In order for an animal to fossilize, he would first have to be buried in dirt. This is a rare story. Typically, he would be eaten first. On the other hand, plant roots are commonly found underground. If you've ever dug in your backyard, you know this. I would expect roots to be the most common fossil in existence. If this is a slow, natural process, the root fossils should stack with every new layer. If an animal corpse can last long enough to produce a fossil, wouldn't you expect roots would also? Logically speaking, a slow, natural geologic column should be a twisted mess of fossilized tree roots.
Hold up, are you trying to say there are no fossilized roots? That doesn't sound right.
I know roots exist, but like any other fossil, they are rare and typically busted up. But we can find recently fossilized roots spanning the top layer, and they look like you'd expect. The common root fossil in the lower layers are not found vertically spanning those layers. Do you think the process that buried these plants in this heap was slow and natural? This top layer example here looks like how all layers should look. Absolutely filled with roots. Roots that match how trees actually live. But only if the layers formed slow and naturally. You know what the common natural tree looks like. The past ones should have left similar looking fossils. We have all seen trees wreaking havoc on rocks today. Why don't we find them wreaking havoc in the past while the layers were forming on top of each other? This example is the underside of tracks. Footprints like these would only form in the wet ground. Wet ground should mean root-bearing plants. Where are the roots and standard ground debris in these layers? Their food chain would require there to be plants. Pay attention to the thickness of the layer of rock that formed on top of the footprints. After the dinosaurs walked here, the ground didn't even have time to dry and crack before those next massive layers arrived on top. Do you suspect it was a bright sunny day when these tracks formed? I suspect they were running from whatever caused these new layers to form. Does this look like a slow and natural process? These are very common educational drawings for the masses. I am sure drawings of dinosaurs getting buried in the swamp looks familiar to you. In a swamp, where would have the next top layer of dirt come from to bury the dinosaurs? Look at all the vegetation and roots and uneven ground. Where is the vegetation, roots, and uneven ground? I challenge you to find something that matches those artist renditions. If you did not know, the lack of ground debris is true for most fossils. The petrified soil has such a pure consistency that fur sticks out like a sore thumb. What were they eating? If the animals did not fully rot away, why did the food? Where are the little rocks, sticks, and leaves? Also notice dead animals that did not live together, yet are found dead together. This does not look natural to me. Where could an animal crawl and die, yet not have a single stick or blade of grass with him? Maybe in the water? You know, rocks and sticks and roots are everywhere. Avoiding plant life didn't work out too well for this guy. You probably recognize this fossil. But how did the rock layers come by and bury that monkey? And without any rocks, roots, or sticks? It appears National Geographic saw sticks and leaves that I must have missed. Where could a monkey have died in a rainforest and not have a single stick imprint along with him? In case you were thinking the vegetation simply rotted away, then why is it that plant fossils can also be found with the same oddly pure soil? Once separated from the plant, you would expect the leaves to wilt rapidly. In the common natural world, where could a broken fern branch land and be surrounded by zero other standard debris? Coal is made of plants. Strangely, when these fossil plants are found together, they are commonly found in mass abundance together. Notice the layer of rock that the coal layer sits on is incredibly flat and contains no evidence of plants. We do not see roots penetrating into this old forest floor. Next is the plant layer known as coal. You don't find much soil or sand or rocks in this. It's near pure plant matter. In the world I'm familiar with, you find plant matter, sticks, rocks, and sand mixed in all of the layers. Look at the depth and width of this coal layer. The thickness here is after decomposing and compressing. How could a layer of plants get this thick naturally? To me, it appears this plant material was redeposited in this massive pile. You can find dinosaur footprints on the ceilings of some coal mines. This means dinosaurs were walking on top of this pile of plants, leaving imprints. Could they have been fighting to find higher ground? Because the next thing that happens in this story is a massive layer covers everything. Looking for a natural explanation, you will find different examples, usually involving swamps. Some give vague descriptions on how the plants got buried by flat rock deposits. Most completely avoid the subject. None explain the purity found in the layering. In nature, you commonly find multiple coal layers separated by flat, rootless stone. Do the actual photos look like the natural explanation? Does this look natural at all? Looking at the coalified plants of the past, they are found on very flat ground. Yet looking at the living plants in the same photo, there is no flat ground to be found. The plants did not live between flat rock layers. It looks as if these layers were deposited in this configuration. Notice the common trees we find in the rock layers. Typically, fossilized trees have lost their roots and limbs. Why is this true, even though the rest of the tree is in such good shape? This screams something catastrophic ripped them off. Many fossilized trees are found spanning vertically through the rock layers. This particular one passes through two separate coal layers. These trees were buried with so much volume that the layered rock extends above the height of the tree. Buried so rapidly that the tree did not have time to decay. Buried so rapidly that the tree remained upright through the process, even though it has no roots to hold it in that position. Buried so rapidly that other plants did not have time to grow roots in the surrounding layers. What looks slow and natural about this process? Even though these trees are vertical, without roots, logic tells me these trees did not grow in this location. They were deposited there. Here is a map of good places to find fossils. Notice the majority are all far inland. Also, fossils tend to uniquely group together. The type of fossils you find in one city are commonly not found 25 miles over. Fossil hunting underwater is too difficult, so nearly every fossil you have ever seen was found on the land, including sea fossils. Kentucky is found here, about as far away from the sea as you can get. Yet sea life are the exact type of fossils found in the northern Kentucky hills, almost exclusively coral and shellfish found in high places. When you look at rocks in this area, you will find many layers with no fossils, and some layers are nothing but fossils. Thin, even, flat layers packed dense with sea life. These critters were not living like this. Clearly, they were later busted up and smashed together. When you want to find sea life, you don't look in the high areas, you look in the low areas, where water collects, and you will find them at the bottom of that. Notice, where coral lives is anything but flat. Do these flat, horizontal, layered Kentucky hills resemble the habitat of current-day sea life? Why is it we repeatedly find in the past flat layers, but the current-day world does not live like that? Do you suspect sea life thrived in the Kentucky high hills in a dense, busted, jumbled mess in near-perfect layers? I suspect they were deposited that way. This shark was found in a Kentucky coal mine. Again, coal is made of massive heaps of dead plants. Was a shark swimming through the forest in Kentucky? Or was he deposited there? Whales, sunbathing this far inland. Is it a coincidence three died next to each other? Or were they deposited there?
No, the area was under the ocean. Then plate tectonics lifted it up.
Are you saying the land was once under the water? I thought you believed in the pre-existing continents of Pangaea. Notice where Kentucky is. On this map, it's even further from the sea. The drawings claim the flat layers form slowly, burying fossils. In order for the layers to build, sediment has to come from somewhere else. The natural explanation has the source of that sediment coming from a larger hill. Let's check out the Kentucky Hill example. Here, the flat sediment layering has been exposed for our convenience. The natural example had the dirt coming from a higher mountain. Let's locate that mountain somewhere miles out in the horizon. This entire area has a massive amount of flat layering buildup. Spotting the source of the sediment should be easy. Seeing how the current green living terrain is so uneven, how is the next layer in the geologic column going to be created as flat as the historical layers of rock? Did you spot the mountain providing the sediment that will create the next layers in the geologic column? Or did you spot the same thing I did? The high, flat layers of the past are being destroyed by erosion, carried downhill into the low river to be deposited into the ocean. But yet, from cradle to grave, we've been shown artwork depicting the layers keep building on top of each other. But every real example I can see with my eyes, there is no stacking. there's only erosion of existing layers. Which layer of paint weathers off first? Most fossils are located because erosion exposed them. Every time you spot sedimentary layers, the past demonstrates flat, even, horizontal layering, and the green, living, current-day parts look very different. In the past, it built up, and current day, it's eroding away. Let's try to find some example photos. Where can I find sedimentary rocks forming today? Examples of sedimentary rocks forming today. Sediments depositing. I find photos here, but they fail to match the geologic column. The drawings claim the flat layers form slowly, bearing fossils on top of older fossils, but I cannot find examples of this. Do you suspect that is exactly why they don't explain how the monkey got from this to this?
Maybe the fossilization process holds some clues. What is the slow, natural explanation for fossil creation?
The explanation depicts a crocodile turning into a fossil under the riverbed. River debris is found in river dirt. Notice this obvious fake example. The artist thought river debris should be included in the soil. Yet, you do not find river debris with legitimate crocodile fossil examples. What riverbed looks like these examples? Also notice, the bottom of rivers look nothing like rock layers. This river is either depositing horizontal layers at the bottom or cutting into the earth. It can't be doing both. Seeing how the walls are high and the river is low, it's definitely cutting.
Rivers build flat riverbanks. It seems like you're going out of your way to ignore that huge flat thing over there covered in houses.
Okay, let's talk about riverbanks. As we already discussed, the hills have fossils. And if you look at riverbanks, you can see they are made of eroded pieces from the rocky hills. This deposit is filled with the contaminated fossils from the old layers. Heavy fossil contamination would make a geologic column useless. Logically, riverbanks cannot be higher than the rivers that built them, so their heights cap out where the floodwaters peak. Which is why it's dangerous to build on a riverbank. A riverbank cannot continue to grow upward.
Maybe it grows upward with the deposits from multiple floods.
Let me ask you this. How old do you think this river is? If the riverbanks are layering up, why, after all these years, are they still barely above the waterline? The example geologic column requires continual upward growth. Riverbanks are lower than the surrounding area. With riverbanks, it would be more like a geologic downward stair step. Isn't it crazy? The moment fossils are not part of the subject matter, the drawings begin accurately depicting nature behaving like nature? Funny how that works. Back to my point. The sediment in the riverbanks do not match the fossils in the hills, as riverbanks are not deposited horizontally. Here is an old riverbank that has been cut into. It's not horizontal layering. A geologic column requires horizontal layering. Also, as this photo shows, riverbanks are temporary. The river is migrating toward this bank, consuming it. This mostly occurs during flooding. The fast-paced water redeposits the riverbanks elsewhere. In order for fossil layers to represent millions of years, they would have to last. Notice the strange swirly patterns in the field. Those swirls are scars left in the earth as the Mississippi River migrated through this area. Rivers cut sideways through the earth, tearing previous riverbanks down and building new ones. It doesn't matter if they cut down a high place or a low place. The replacements they build cannot be higher than the river that built them. When flooding occurs, the water causes mass erosion and rivers migrate. As we zoom out, you will see a purple line. The purple line represents where the river was when the state boundaries were defined. But you can see in many places, the river is no longer in that documented location. When we zoom out further, you'll start to notice a giant scar on the earth where the Mississippi has migrated over its long history of cutting. You can see this massive scar from space. I built this overlay to demonstrate where the scar is in respect to the state lines. This is a fossil map. They have cataloged fossil finds in respect to their location on the Earth. The colored bubbles on the map represent those finds. When you combine the Mississippi scar overlay to the fossil map, you will notice rivers are terrible at creating fossils. But rivers are good at exposing fossils that were already under the ground. To you, does it look like these layers were created by rivers? Or does it look like a river may have exposed the layering? This one's great. Fish dies and is buried in the ocean. And how does the fish go from the depths of the ocean to the top of the hills? Let's read line number 4. Turns in the fossil, takes millions of years, and the fossil will appear on the surface of the soil. That explanation deserves a gold star for dodging. Here, the animal dies on the beach, and the ocean rises, covering the dinosaur and its footprints. I kid you not, the dinosaur and its footprints form into fossils under the ocean. Look at the waves smashing on the shoreline. Are the footprints of your youth fossilizing on some beach? Would a dead animal stay intact as it is slowly buried under the crashing waves? When you visited the beach, do you recall it behaving in the manner that matches the natural example? Beaches are the spot where the land meets the ocean. Does it appear the ocean is growing the land up? Or is this the spot where the ocean is consuming the land? Under the water, you will see a large plateau of sediment. I suspect this formation consists of eroded sediment that was once on top of the land. When you look with your own eyes, what do you see? Sand coming out of the ocean and traveling on top of the land? Or is the soil coming off the land and going into the ocean? Could it be the outer layers of land is eroding into the ocean? Therefore, erosion is exposing the fossils of today.
Hold the phone. Barrier islands grow over time, and I have seen that with my own eyes. Of course the beaches grow.
Correct. Beaches on the small scale do build, but this type of building is temporary. They are deposited, they move, and they are destroyed. The geologic column would require a more permanent buildup. When we look at beach erosion, we get a convenient cutaway. Do you see distinct layering in common sand of today? Yet the common animal fossils of the past are typically found laying flat on their side, at the exact spot in the rock's layering where the top layer has a clean, breaking separation from the bottom layer. A pile of beach sand does not produce this clean breaking spot. This chart does not match up to beach activity. If the top layer was produced by the beach and is at sea level, how did the lower layers get under there?
Maybe the layers are forming under the ocean in that sand plateau down there, and the future plate tectonics will push it up out of the water, giving us layered rock with fossils.
Sure, let's entertain this natural explanation one last time and compare if it is the source of the flat fossil layering. Once again, I must note, this natural explanation flushes the other natural theory of Pangaea down the toilet. This natural explanation puts the deposited layers starting under the ocean. This fails to explain why many fossil layers do not include sand or sea life. Clearly, these tracks were formed on land. How did they end up buried under ocean sediment that later fossilized? If the layers were deposited under the ocean, why are there so many layers that are not full of sand? If you have been to the beach, you know the ground slopes down, away from the land. The common rock strata that I am familiar with is flat and even for miles in all directions. Notice the large variety of rock types. Does this look anything like the bottom of the ocean? What about the sediment deposited under the ocean? Where can we find flat, even sediments not containing sand? Strangely, it looks exactly how we expect it to. Nothing like the rock layers. Look at all of these hungry critters. I would expect any dead land animal that made it down here would likely get destroyed by sea life. Huh, the sea must have not been hungry in the past. Look at all of the intact wings. I even spot mosquitoes. Do you suspect a mosquito would stay intact as it traveled to the bottom of the ocean? According to this natural theory of ocean sediment creating the rock layers, we have animals and deposits going underwater, creating the layers under the ocean. Then the waterline moves, exposing the sediment layers above the waterline. Those fossil layers I will mark in dark purple. The fossils formed where the sediment was at the time they were buried, and now they are no longer under the water. But now there's another batch of fossils and sediment brewing under the ocean. Because the location where the water meets the land has moved, the deposits will be in a different place on the ocean floor. I've marked this next batch of ocean sediment layers in gray. That layer too will come out of the ocean, exposing its fossils. And of course, the next era in time, once again, can only deposit where the land meets the ocean, marked in blue. Here we have a map of the U.S., color-coded according to elevation. You can see these three western states, marked in dark purple, are high in elevation. Once this high purple area is out of the ocean, new ocean sediment cannot form there. Therefore, the oldest fossils would exclusively be found in the high central areas. This is a fossil map, showing where fossils have been found across the U.S. We've selected the Cambrian period. The colored bubbles represent fossils claimed to be 540 million years old. These fossils are in layers up high, as expected. But as we go through the different fossil eras, to the most recent, notice they all appear in the highest of highs. If sediment forms in the low areas, how did new fossils form in these high areas? But there's another issue. The blue states to the east are in the low zones. This low eastern zone, marked in blue, would have been the last to come out of the ocean, and would have been too far away from land to have any early fossils. Yet on the fossil map, once again, notice every era of fossil appears across the U.S., and they appear at every elevation.
Oh, that must be why we now understand the ocean rose and fell in the past.
In this natural explanation, notice the low spot in the center. Jurassic, Triassic, and Permian all show the ocean level at the low current levels of today. Yet, when we view those three low sea level eras on the fossil map, we find their fossils buried in sediment in the high areas. Unfortunately, sea level fluctuation doesn't help the natural explanation's case. Let's also compare this idea to photographical evidence. The green areas are where we live today. It's not flat. The top layer is exposed to the elements, so it suffers from erosion. You will find common examples where nature is cutting through the sediment layers of the past, exposing areas that were once large and flat, leaving visual scars. These visual scars of today include plants penetrating down into the ground. Let's take a moment and apply this erosion scarring to logic. Let's say some type of magic happened, and the layers built evenly on top of each other. And due to rain, rivers, and other general weathering, we had erosion. Also, life-giving plants had their effect, creating a top layer with a rough terrain, like today. Everything leaving a historical visual record in the layered rock. More time passes, and more unexplained, even flat layers appear. Lakes take their toll and leave their mark. Plants take their toll and leave their mark. More time passes. More erosion. The natural process has millions of years to play with here. Then more of those unexplainable, vastly large, even, flat, horizontal layers appear on top. When we look through the layers, we should see historical scars from periods in time where there was living. Periods in time that resemble today's terrain. Notice what exposure to the elements has done to the terrain of today. But when you look at the lower layers, do you spot any time in history with a similar, uneven terrain? Locate a historical layer that shows signs of erosion. Because fossils can be found in these layers, it means the animals existed when the layers were deposited. Can you spot the erosion marks in the historical layers? I spot current-day plants in the lower left. Can you spot the petrified roots of the past? Did no plants live during the formation of any of these layers? The natural explanation shows plants and eroded soil, hills, valleys, lakes, and rivers. But where is this eroded layer visible in the rock layers? There is an uncommon type of layer called a disconformity. When we look at the drawings, we see examples that match what we're looking for. Layers under the ground with drastic edges, and they look natural. Yet the photographical examples of these real disconformity lines have a flat or smooth surface. They look nothing like the eroded surface of today. They also lack that natural look of the erosion around them. Isn't it odd the artwork and the real-world examples are not a match? Why do you suppose that would be? You can tell this entire area should be as high and flat as the cliffs in the horizon. See the green erosion marks of today? Do you see anything imprinting through the historical layers of the past that matches the eroded, uneven terrain of today? Coal is plant matter. This means these lower layers were exposed as the top layer for a period of time. If they were exposed, why no erosion marks matching the rest of the view? Hundreds of thin layers, no erosion damage between any of them. These dino tracks were exposed as the top layer in the past, when the animal stepped here. I would expect rain, wind, and plants to destroy these imprints. Instead, another layer was laid on top, without bonding to or destroying the imprints. A dinosaur was walking through Virginia. And later, 200 feet of flat, lifeless layers followed. Looking from above, do you see all of those trees? If a dinosaur walked through this area today, and a layer of mud covered his tracks, preserving them, shouldn't there be millions and millions of buried tree parts also? Does it not seem odd that this entire area grew 200 feet, and the things we find are the least likely thing to survive? Mud footprints that were covered by mud. After mud lands on mud, it shouldn't even separate. It should just be thick mud. This lump is a dinosaur footprint. The layers are flat, consecutive, and independent, each one with no signs of life. Yet an animal was walking here between two depositing layers. Does this look slow and natural to you? Notice how independent the layers are of each other. It's not just one thick layer with varying color, What behaves like this today? Also notice how deep the footprint is through the layers. It would take an enormous amount of energy to walk through mud like this. Do you suspect this animal wanted to walk through this muck? It's not easy for us to walk through it. The mud suctions to your legs. Notice all the photos of stuck elephants on this page. I suspect an animal of the past would not wander out into a mud plain unless it had no other choice. And animals are not the only ones walking around on this plantless, flat, muddy terrain. Don't humans tend to avoid slopping through the mud? Maybe it was because, for these individuals, there was no other alternative. Maybe they were fighting to survive the mechanism that was repetitively layering the ground. This is a recent discovery of people standing in the mud in the past. You can see the toe imprints. From this view, you can see the thin layers laid one on top of the other, each independent. You can see the texture it had when it was buried, no plants between them. The layers continued to come, one after the other, until the ground got to the height of the flat layers seen in the background. And these fossils were found the same way most fossils are found. Erosion exposed them. In the past, flat layers were laid down burying animals, one after another. We can see nothing natural in our current day that matches up to what happened in the past.
I'm sorry, just because the author of this video hasn't shown us a solution doesn't mean there isn't a solution.
That is a very true statement, and I have found something that I've been holding out on.
An unexpected match.
We have been focusing on older fossils and their layers, but there are, in fact, newer fossil layers. This recent fossil you see here died and was buried from falling volcanic ash. It looks strikingly similar to older fossil examples that remained fully intact. Just like older fossil layers, there's no ground debris in ash layers. This is because the volcanic ash plume didn't come from the ground surface. It came from the inside of a volcano. Then it created that familiar, flat, thin layer. This is because the ash fell evenly from the sky. As the ash came down, it killed and buried these animals rapidly. Notice we see the same key details in this recent fossil layer formation as ones found deep within the geologic layering. These examples here are normal fossils. Notice how visually similar they look to the ashfall examples. These footprints were left in volcanic ash. Notice the lack of roots and lack of erosion. That's because these layers came sequentially and rapidly. That wall you see in the back is the layers that came next and preserved the details on the ground. Why were people walking around in this stuff? Because there wasn't anywhere else to walk. They were out possibly checking on loved ones and trying to escape. Then the rest of those layers dumped down. I suspect these people were probably fighting for survival. These older stone dinosaur footprint examples are not made of ashfall, but yet visually are a match. That wall in the background is the layers that came next and protected the footprints from the elements. Do you suspect this dinosaur was fighting for survival? Pompeii is another recent example that we're all familiar with. Ash fell from above, burying the victims rapidly, preserving their shape and details. Curiously, old fossils in stone can be found with the same traits. These ash layers fell rapidly from the sky. Notice how similar they look to the other layers we've looked at. If this handy arrow wasn't here, pointing out the ash layer, could you even tell which layer it was? The layers that we know fell from the sky are indistinguishable from the layers we believe that didn't. This geologic layering example is a visual match to the ashfall layers that fell from the sky.
You mean the rock layers are made out of volcanic ash?
Believe me, I wish I was saying that, but none of these materials have any business raining down from the sky, and at the same time, it looks precisely that way.
This diagram has sand layers, and sand gets airborne. That doesn't sound so crazy.
Look again at the layers in the diagram. Be honest with yourself. Is sand a visual match? Is it stacking into independent horizontal layers? Do you see any sand forming on top of that rock structure in the background? That's because sand isn't building new layers on top of old. Are footprints going to form or preserve in this stuff? Let's go through some more examples. What do your eyes tell you? Snow falling from the sky to the ground also produces the same outcome as the geologic layers went through, creating these large, even, flat, horizontal layers with no ground debris. Falling snow also buries animals as the layers stack up. Falling snow also can capture and preserve footprints. Notice how similar fallen snow looks in every regard to the other geologic layers we've looked at. Falling from the sky and landing on the ground is a process that is natural for ash and snow. Falling ash and snow are visually a match to the stone layers, almost as if this material fell from the sky and stacked these layers up. Vastly large, even, flat, horizontal, and yet gently preserve the footprints. How else did this abundance of material travel here and gently preserve the footprints?
Are you honestly saying that soil fell from the sky in mass abundance?
Hey, I'm with you. Originally, I also was expecting to find a semi-natural cause. Wikipedia provides photos of what the rock layers look like, along with multiple natural alternative answers. River silt, beach sand, coal swamp, sand dune, and lava beds. Let's quickly glance at each alternative. River silt. It's not flat. It's not vast. Deposits exclusively in the low river valleys, the very place the river will carve it out again later. Beach sand. Doesn't layer. Coal swamps mainly consist of artwork and computer renderings. Why do you suspect there's not much for photos on this subject? Probably because the bottom of swamps isn't coal and does not look like the rock layers. Sand dunes doesn't look anything like rock layers. Lava beds is the only partial match listed, but the majority of rock layers are not made out of this stuff. Their own natural explanations do not match their own example photos. After looking at the natural versions of the story, examples that fell from the sky, like the one before you, are the only ones that match up. If you recall the three hands-on science project examples, they did not utilize any of the naturally discussed methods. They recreated the stacked layers faithfully by pouring a new layer down from above. Look at the ultra-thin defined layers in this photo. For your convenience, focus on the bright pink thin layer directly behind the lady. Can you imagine another natural process that could relocate this pink material here from someplace else and spread it this perfectly thin and even? It did not mix into the layer above it or below it. The layer remained perfectly thin and distinct, like all the other layers in this photo. Here we see a variety of rock types. The layers look different because they are made of different stuff, but their deposit pattern appears the same. This would be because each layer was deposited here by an identical method, yet the material varied. The idea of this material raining down from the sky to build these layers sounds ridiculous, but look at them. What other natural process could spread material as perfectly even and distinct as these layers? Layers that continue into the distance for hundreds of miles. From an aerial view, we can get a better understanding. The land is made out of those layers you see there. They are a mile thick, and they extend further in the distance than you can see.
If you're correct, and it was distributed evenly by falling to the earth, there may still be a natural explanation for that.
Before you spend too much time guessing, let's crank up the difficulty once again. As you recall, coal is made out of once-living plants. These plant deposit layers look no different than the rest of the layers. All sedimentary rock layers share the same quirky, unnatural properties, even organic ones. Was plant material also raining down from above to produce near perfectly even layers? What about rock layers made exclusively out of fossils? They also share that same deposit pattern. The perfectly even, flat layers you see here continue out for miles. Snow and ash are known to fall from the sky and deposit in this configuration today. Does this look familiar? This process can generate consistent, thin layers that can extend in every direction for miles. This process can generate hard, thick, heavy layers evenly on something as fragile as snow. Back to the historical layers. Once more, focus on that visually distinct layer. If a layer that thin fell on the ground today, without a top layer to protect it, how long would it remain that perfect? Imagine what rain, wind, animals, and plants would do to it. And all the varieties of rock remained perfectly distinct and undamaged for years, while waiting for the next perfect layer to form? The only answer I can see is all those layers were laid down sequentially and with minimal time between each layer. The idea of this material raining down from the sky to build these layers sounds ridiculous, but look at them. How much more ridiculous is it to think they were laid down slowly over hundreds of millions of years, and each layer remained perfectly flat, distinct, and unweathered? No rivers formed, no trees rooted. And we see distinct varieties of rock. Look at them. A single uphill source should produce a single type of rock, if it occurred naturally. Remember, the coal plant layer delivered no root damage in the layer below it. Without taking root here, these plants could have not lived here. What other process could have relocated these plants to this location, flat and even like this? A pattern that visually matches the rest of the layers. Regardless of the building material, layers formed on top of each other in the same configuration. A configuration that does not match the ground of today. As you look up through the layers, notice how flat each layer is, all the way to the top. Some of the layers in this photo are made of ash, known to disperse from above and deposit flat on the ground. Some layers are not ash, and had no business being in the sky. By looking, guess which layers are which. If you would like a clue, look at the bottom, where the grass is. Here we see an example of dirt behaving naturally. What about rock layers made exclusively out of fossils? If soil, plant parts, and critters were ripped out of the ground in one location, relocated, and dropped from above, the creation of these hills would represent something terrifying, a complete destruction and recreation of the earth. This short read is the entire story of the flood from the Bible. Being this short, clearly not every detail of this event has been provided to us, but you will find it abundantly clear the rising floodwaters killed the people and the critters. God also explained when he destroyed the animals, he will also destroy the earth. Maybe the unnatural destruction of the earth and its recreation happened unnaturally. Maybe the reason for 40 days of rain is because animals like this one fought to the bitter end to stay alive.
Whoa. Listen, I don't think you understand. I don't want to believe in your Bible or your God.
Isn't that the crux of it all? Everyone is looking for the answers that validate what they already chose to believe. No one is honestly looking for the truth. Maybe that's why in 740 pages, and after 13 editions, the authors of this book chose to avoid a detailed explanation of how 70% of what we see formed. They fail to mention the anomalies that disagree with their logic, and yet call it an earth science book. I suspect the authors of this book have a bias towards naturalism, because they too do not want my God. But if you're going to exclude unnatural answers because you don't like them, then this book isn't science, it's naturalism. Don't allow them to get away with calling it science. Naturalists, who do not want God, concluded this drawing of the geologic column because this is what they wanted to find. This is not the solution of science. Evidence has been excluded. Causes have been excluded. A desired outcome was in mind before they even started. And, as typical, the theory is displayed in art, not photos. Science is not at odds with the Bible. True science doesn't care about the Bible, natural or supernatural. Science is the search for answers. It's only the naturalists and the Christians that are at odds. Everyone will evaluate the photo in the background exclusively by what they already chose to believe, and then claim the other side is an idiot. I have yet to meet a single person who does not share this trait. Why do you believe people claiming to be scientists are any different? A naturalist exclusively wants a natural answer. When I started this video, I was scared I would find evidence that would disprove God. It's scary when your belief system is threatened. I admit I was scared there was a lion waiting in the box. I mean, a lot of professionals who say they know what they're talking about say there's a lion in there. I didn't want to open it. I didn't want to release it. I didn't want to let it out, and I was afraid I couldn't get it back in. But the further I cracked the box open, the more obvious it was, there was no lion in there. What I found instead is evidence geologists already know there are major problems with their claimed evidences. You can see it in every documentary, diagram, and website. They mostly dodge the issues, and they rarely show their evidences. If these people were scientists, there would be no need to dodge anything. Then why are these naturalists dodging the major issues with their theories? Because they too are scared of the lion in the box called the Bible. They too don't want their belief system shook up. So they ignore the issues that don't line up with their pre-chosen belief system and only focus on the evidences that appear to coincide. Quit allowing naturalists to call themselves scientists. Excluding evidence is not science. The next time you read an article where scientists determine blase blase, remember, when they say scientists, they actually mean naturalists. And when they refer to science, they actually mean naturalism. Then when you read the paper, you can be like, naturalists found the AABG conclusions they set out to find. That's rather expected. The next time you take a flight, look out the window and ask yourself, from up here, I can see everything. If there was a continuous building process generating a geologic column as the naturalists say there is, how is the next layer of dirt going to get on top of what I see here already? Where would it even come from? I can see rivers transporting dirt to the ocean. They are brown because they have dirt in them. But where is the building process? What else has been taught to me that I shouldn't believe? Sadly, it's evident we failed the Queen.
How did our heroes get fossilized up on this mountain? Some of the most brilliant minds are hard at work pondering this very issue. Did they get covered by sediment from that river down below the cliffs? Maybe they ventured down into the low valley, and it became a hill in the desert. Maybe they walked through that computer-rendered coal swamp. Maybe they laid down on a beach, and they were slowly covered along with their footprints. One thing is for sure, it was a natural process. Soon a natural answer will be located. Stay tuned to your local TV station for more one-sided updates.
Questions and answers.
You lied. Not all rock deposits are perfectly flat and horizontal.
Are rock layers that lack uniformity suddenly explainable? Are they being created today? Or are they also exclusively eroding away?
You lied. I found natural examples of things you said don't exist.
The Earth is huge. You will be able to find rare examples of just about anything. But if your goal is truth, you should inquire common examples to explain the common world around us. Still convinced you found the answer? Please provide me the latitude and longitude of where I can see your example in action. I would love to have the opportunity to compare your example to the actual large-scale rock layers. Maybe you solved it.
If the ground isn't increasing, why are archaeologists always digging?
There are natural reasons the past can be buried. But the majority of things they dig up, corpses, which people bury, foundations, which people bury, and trash pits, which people bury.
It would take millions of years for all that erosion. You Christians still don't have a leg to stand on.
Sure, at slow speeds, water barely erodes. But the higher the volume of water, the faster it moves. And fast-moving water is what produces the majority of erosion. One nasty flood can produce more erosion than that of 100 years of the day-to-day. In the Bible, the unnatural flood is described as exceeding the height of the mountains, and it required 150 days to recede. I would assume there was a massive amount of water producing a massive amount of erosion. If you tried to bend these stone layers today, they would crack. This would prove these layers were soft at one time. While these layers were still soft, they were likely more susceptible to erosion. Erosion is a big concern for a lot of people. Here's a hint. These charts are not here because these places are gaining soil over time. Someone looking for an exclusively natural answer will find erosion a much more challenging problem.